lesson we read out loud was a long one. I'll just read the first couple of verses again. This reminder, Jesus is doing kind of something like a diagnostic. He's telling us something. We'll explore the whole concept later, but we'll start out with just these words. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I tell you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council. Whoever says, you fool, will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you're offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. It's one of the most insidious, dangerous, and difficult to detect dangers of all. That thing we call an inside job. When the forces of destruction are within us and not attacking from outside. You know, you can prepare for outside opposition, but when it's inside, we typically aren't aware of it until it's done its destroying work. And while that's very tragic for a business, for a nation, for a family, the inside job of sin is most eternally dangerous to all of us. That's why Jesus used such strong language and such hyperbolic imagery and examples in his sermon that he gave from the Mount that we read in today's gospel. None of us really knows by nature how deadly sin actually is. Now, as Jesus said, we know that acting out certain things is pretty tough. Murder, you're taking someone's actual physical life. We know that it ends a life, and it brings about a certain amount of destruction to families and deserved retribution. But what about that simple thing of being angry? You know, we all get mad and call names and put people down and try to straighten them out and put them in their place and insult others and act as if we're more important than them. How can that be as bad as killing somebody? How is lusting after someone and not doing anything about it? But, ooh, look at him. Ooh, look at her. How can that be as bad as actually committing adultery and having sex outside of marriage that breaks homes and wrecks lives? Well, what Jesus is trying to get across to us in this very pointed message today is the inside job, the inside problem behind all those thoughts and actions is not recognizing that each and every sin, whether we think it's little or huge, each and every sin is a rejection of the Lord God and His standards. It's His way of, our way of saying, no, I'll decide what's holy. I'll decide what's true. I'll decide if I want to love someone and what that looks like. To even want to sin, Jesus is telling us, is letting that fallen, rebellious nature we're all born with lead us in a war against the sovereignty, the rule of God. And even wanting to sin is to hate His ways, His rule, His purpose, to hate Him. And sin has serious wages. Paul wrote that to the Romans, the wages of sin is death. Not time out, not a little time off of the internet. No, death. And that's what the problem is. The initial impulses we have to hide it, to make it smaller, to maybe not execute it, that doesn't take away how serious this whole problem of sin is. It's no use for us to deny it. We can't even blame God for it. James 1 says, no one when he's tempted should say, God's tempting me. Instead, it comes from our own evil desires that conceive it and bring it to birth and bring us down with it. Even those hyperboles Jesus used about cutting off your hand or plucking out your eye to fight sin, even those things show that really, where's the problem? It isn't just what we do. Sin's problem is by nature who we are. Because getting rid of an eye or a hand, well, that's just the agent that carries out, but it was a thought inside. Let's maybe bring that up to date these days. If I were to say to you, to stop sinning, throw away your smartphone, that would be saying, well, it's Snapchat or Facebook that makes you jealous or covet, and it's Twitter that makes you angry and hateful. No. Maybe those things add fuel to the fire, but we can't blame the internet. We can't blame outside things for the problem that lives within us. Those fires are fed by outside influences, but they're already burning. So what's the answer? If throwing away all, if people tried to just, I'll go live in a cave somewhere and I won't sin. It didn't work. So what is the solution? We need another inside job. That is, we need something to happen inside of us that we can't do. We need someone to come inside of us and make us new. That is exactly what God does in baptism. He claims us as his own and begins to do what David prayed for in Psalm 51. He begins to put a new and right spirit within us. A new heart, not the blood pumping organ, but the spirit, the things we value, the us that doesn't die when this heart and body quit. The soul, the new spirit that comes from Christ alone. That the Spirit brings when he brings us to repentance. What does that mean? When the Spirit says, yes, Jesus, all you said about true was sin, and I don't want to go that way anymore. Jesus, turn me around. Make me go 180 degrees differently. Jesus, turn my heart to God. And Jesus does that. He turns us back with the most powerful tool ever invented, his own holy precious blood, that can erase any sin, that can give life to the dead, that makes you and I the renewed, perfect children of God. Perfect not because of what we do, but perfect because Jesus' holiness covers over all the wrong that we've done, and God looks at it no more and sees us only as those made new by the Son. When that happens, the inside job that God does starts to act outside. All of a sudden, we start looking for things to praise God for that I've complained about. We thank God for there's a warm building when it's cold outside. We thank God for those kids making all that noise, because life would sure be lonely without children and grandchildren. We thank God that he's brought us into a church, even though the pastor talks a long time when he prays and we're never out of here on time. But we thank God that we're told we're wonderfully loved. And then we begin to use that life outside. And we forgive the people who sin against us because we've been forgiven. The inside forgiveness becomes an outside action as we who have extra begin to feed the hungry. And we who have comfort and peace because we've been through tough things come alongside those who are suffering and maybe put our arm around them or listen to their complaints and their hurts and their sorrows and say, but God will bring you through it because he did for me. When you and I begin to be new inside, our outside changes too. The world that we see becomes to us the place where we can share the love of God. So our offering becomes not something I have to do, but something I want to do. So we have a place to teach kids and to send people out from, to tell the word of God in Hong Kong or South Korea or South Africa or anywhere around the world, or around Lincoln County for that matter. We hear the word of God and we want others to be made new. We want others to have the peace of knowing that no matter what our troubles we have, we can take it to the Lord in prayer and he will hear. when this inside job of making us new from the inside out happens as God comes to us in His Word and sacraments, then instead of being destroyed and broken, we're refreshed, we're new with the children of God who will live forever. That's what He wants for you and for me and for everyone, made new on the inside, made new eternally. God grant it to us all. Amen. Now may the peace of God that surpasses all human understanding keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen.